Yes, time frame's a good question, and it's something that, in terms of my strategy, I've come and found my own truth, so I'll share that. And as I trade a trend with a trend, I don't look to pick reversals because often reversals have a lower success rate and they don't turn out to be reversals. In other words, going back to that Isaac Newton and that Einstein type philosophies, things continue to move generally. In other words, they're moving for a reason. So on basis, I train continuous patterns, or continuation. I have a trend time view. I then have a pattern view where I'm looking at the setup as it is, the squeezing of the volatility. It stopped going up for a while, it's resting. And then I have what I call a trigger time frame, which will be the time frame whereby you're actually looking at the specifics of the market to get your unique high 3 point and when the breakout is going to happen. So that is very focused on timing. So one is, where is the, which direction is the river flowing? You know, is it flowing, where is south, you know, downstream? Get that right. That's your macro time frame. So typically the best time patterns are taken on the larger time frame. They're more consistent broadly. You're less likely to be flicked out, particularly if you're in Forex. A variety of other underlying markets can be a bit choppy at times. So I would say you want a trend time frame, which is maybe a daily chart, can even be weekly or monthly, to H4, 4 hours. Your pattern time frame, where you're looking specifically at the setup and identifying the aspects of it. So if it's, I'm talking about a symmetrical triangle, you know, your three highs, your three lows, the pinch, that would be 1 quarter thereof. So if you're on a daily, on your trend time frame, I would be on my pattern view, 4 hourly. And then when I'm looking at just that third high and that third low and that move that takes it through the high three, that reasserts the bull trend, that would be my trigger and timing time frame. I want to really pick that third high and get that stop neatly nailed, and the point at which I enter with a pending order. Note also, it's a pending order. In other words, the market must take you in. This actually eliminates a lot of bad calls. In other words, if it breaks down and is a reversal instead, you don't get taken in. Most people are getting in on market orders because they say, oh, I must be in. The market's moving, and they jump. They're momentum chasers by our default, because you want to be excited. It's going up. You want to be part of it. You chase the train. So a pending order is more about a price level falling than a specific moment in time that you want to be in the market. So that trigger time frame would be a quarter of the 4 hourly. So you would have a daily trend, you'd have 4 hourly pattern, and you would have 1 hour for capturing that final third high and third low, which represent the breakout and the stop loss placement. Bang, those are my three time frames. So I'm actually looking at three. The first one, once you've got that right, it's nailed, you can set aside. Then you concentrate on the other two.
Okay, and in terms of how many, you know, that is intensive. So how many markets are you following?
It's driven by finding the specific setup. So I tend to only be interested once there's already a chart that has had a strong trend, that is in the continuation pattern and has already given me my first pullback and the second bounce and the second pullback that is not as low. So it's already given me two clear impulses and is tightening. Then I start to say, okay, this is looking interesting. So that becomes just a watch list candidate, and depending on how it's progressing, as long as it continues to comply, we become more and more interested in it. And as we start getting to the third high and third low, we're focusing on the trigger time frame. So how many markets? I don't have a number. I don't say 10. Anything that I can find, and I have a number of scanning tools where I can find a liquid market that is giving me the circumstances, is potentially interesting.
Okay. Talk a bit more about predicting price direction and its importance in your trading style.
So direction. So as I've probably alluded to, we're continuation orientated. So broadly speaking, we are buying the trend that is already apparent. If it shows us that it is ready to reassert again to the upside. So it has to be self-confirmatory as well by virtue of its continuation. So rather than, so I keep my direction very, it's very, very simple. We believe the original direction is correct until such time as it's proven to be incorrect. So I apply what I call the assumptive theory. We continue to keep on believing you're moving up as long as you keep showing that that's what you've been doing. In other words, once again, referring it almost to that object in space that is moving, it will continue to move until such time as some new element enters into the market in space that pushes it in another direction. And as you've noticed with our solar system and all of these things, we are continuing to move for a long, long time. And only when we get hammered by one huge star or asteroid are we going to cease to move in that way. And it's been highly predictable for many, many years. And if we get astronomical, you know, you can say it'll probably be the case our entire lifetime and many people's lifetimes before and after us. So for me, that makes logical sense for a trend. The market is revaluing, say, an equity or a commodity or even an FX pair. And what happens is we're not a fruit fly. You don't go from at that point an event, suddenly all the information becomes universally available to all the people and it just fruit fly jumps from there to there. The way market responds is you have to cope with people's expectations and re-rating of value. And it takes a while over time for people to see someone in a new light or to revalue a company in a new light. And this is what is the birth sign of equities. And after doing quite a lot fairly briskly for a while, it will pause in that process. So in the same way as you climb a step, you know, you go up, you flatline, you go up, you flatline. So I'm exploiting that.
It's common sense.
To me, it feels like a logician's way.
It does. I mean, when you talk about it like that, is, you know, it is, it's back to the very basics, isn't it?
Yes. Well, you'll be amazed how many people, when teaching, that are always trying to sell something that is going up. And are always trying to buy something that is making new lows. And I've never understood why. You know, it's almost like saying, can I swim upstream to the top of the mountain from whence it has come? And I say, well, I'd sooner go down to the beach and see who gets there first, you know.
Yeah. What's the most important part of your strategy during a regular day? You know, what's your number one thing?
I think analysis, not the actual trading. The amount of work and drawing you do on your chart pre actually taking in is what gives you the confidence. I've always found I'm my most confident on a trade when I've really opened the chart up. Historically, I've looked to see how it's performed. How has it continued before? Drawn the patterns, projected the targets, were they made? Thrown all my key levels of significance through the chart, seen it's come back, visited, supported, moved back up. Really got inside the price behavior that I feel I understand this animal. You know, you wouldn't start committing surgery on a being that you've never studied before. Why would you start trading something that you've not properly got under the skin of?
Good. What do you feel are some of the advantages of following a tested strategy aside from a better opportunity to win?
So tested strategies, I'm assuming you're talking about something that's systemic, where you can actually run almost black box and you generate notional trades. In that instance, I feel the biggest advantage of a tested strategy is actually the process of defining the strategy in the first place. Because too many people, when I speak, and this is once again my value of having taught traders, that they say, here are my rules. And then when I watch how they implement them, they actually say, well, I didn't do that one because of that, and I didn't do this one. So I said, well, where's that as part of your rules, though? So you're actually discretionally bending the initial rules that you wrote down because you're not actually trading your actual system in terms of how you defined it, or you're actually adding a new level of rules that you haven't yet incorporated into your rules. So one or two has got to happen. You've either got to stop messing with what you originally wrote down and trade what you've defined, or if that which you think is an important criteria, define that criteria and reintegrate it into your system. So what you actually find is you start being forced to make decisions about what you really want. You can't get what you want in life until you define it and can write it down. So in the same way in trading, you have to say, I'm going to have to let some of those trading patterns go. I quite like them, but sometimes they really sting you. They go the wrong way. And when they do that and that, it could be good, but it could be bad. Let's just focus on the ones that give me the results that I always need. And you're being forced to eliminate and to define. That process of defining the system is the most valuable part for me. The testing then gives you the outcomes of that work and tells you if you're basing your thinking on a failed fallacy or not. If you can't make over a long run a reasonable return on testing, you will never make it in reality on that. So the testing is a clear point of where your idea is put to the sword if not justifiable. And then you are living in a fool's paradise, so you must come up with another system. But at least it gives you closure and you can let it go.